and the light feels so dim. It's not like me just to give up, so I'm bringing you my dry bones, breathing me again. I need that wind to stop blowing, I need these eyes to be open, I need my heart to keep hoping, so I'm
we'll be right back. test. Okay. Hey, good morning, everybody. Good morning. Like the new decorations? Heard some comments that said they wish that we'd leave these up year-round. That's a little, I don't know. I think I get tired of seeing all the kangaroos and the koala bears and the things like that, but that's all right. Maybe in one of your houses, you know, if somebody really likes them, maybe you could make a deal with the Christian Ed team. They give you this stuff to decorate your home with. You could do some themes in your home. So, hey, I'm going to do the welcome. Got one announcement this morning from the safety team. We are starting a key control program, and that means we'd like to know who all has keys for the church. Just so for liability purposes and for tracking, if a person, a family would happen to move away and has a key, we could say, hey, can we have your key back before you leave? Just so we know where all the keys are. There's no, you know, we're not doing anything cynical with the key program. We just need to know. And it's been years, almost 20 years we've been in this building, and we've changed some locks and some things like that, so we know there's a lot of keys out there. So we simply just want to know if you have a key. We're going to make a list so that we can keep track of that and know who's in and out of the building and where those keys are in the future. So if you can, over the next several weeks, get with Keith Teagarden or Aaron Doak or even one of the trustees or myself as an elder, let us know you've got it. We'll write your name down. And we're going to start compiling a list because I think we'll be amazed at how many keys we have out there once we have our list compiled. I bet you there's 40 or 50 keys floating around out there. And you may not even know you have a key. You may be looking in the drawer like, what is this key for? Like, well, that's a church key. So other than that, if you'll stand, we're going to open with a word of prayer. Worship team's coming up to get ready to worship. And we will get started with our morning. Let's pray. Father God, we do thank you for loving us. We thank you for bringing us here this morning to worship you, to fellowship, and to be among fellow believers. Father, we thank you that you have given us a hope that's reflected in our attendance on Sunday mornings, in our obedience to you, and our willingness to share our lives with others. Father, we thank you so much that Christ died for us. We come this morning to sing songs to you, to bring joy to your heart. Father, let these songs be pleasing. And let those songs build us up one another. We ask these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you. Be seated. Good morning. As Dan so graciously pointed out, we are in VBS week now, and that's why all of the decorations are up this week. And one of the themes for this year's VBS is Zoomerang, and it's all about bringing the kids back to what the Bible has to say, kind of like a boomerang, just how we bring them all back to just the basics of the Bible and what it has to say. And this year, it is specifically about the basics of the value of life. And I think just this year, with everything going on, that message is just more important than ever, that the kids just realize how important it is that we have life, but also that we have life in Jesus. And so a few verses I wanted to share with you guys today are found in 1 John chapter 5, verses 11 and 12. They say, "This is the testimony that God has given about his son. God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his son. Whoever has the son has life. Whoever does not have the son of God does not have life." And I think sometimes we try to overcomplicate the word and just everything that it says. And so I think sometimes it's just nice to go back to the basics and just think about how the thing that truly matters is that Jesus died for all of us, no matter who we are, no matter what we do, and no matter what we continue to do. And because he did that, we have life, and we have the hope of eternal life because Jesus died for us, and Jesus gave us that gift of life. So I think that's a really good message, not only for the kids this week, but also for us as we go throughout our day. Will you bow your heads with me as we pray? Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this morning, and we thank you for the chance that we just get to come together and be in your house today. We thank you that you sent your son to die for all of us, no matter what we do and no matter how sinful we are. We thank you that you continue to love us anyway, and we just thank you for the hope that you give us for the future. And it's in your name that we pray. Amen. And there are communion stations around the room, so you can get up whenever you would like.
Pain is gone and mercy fills the streets. To look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. There will be a day when all will bow before him. Yeah.
some of the words of those songs we sang. I don't know if you guys are able to just get into it immediately, or if it takes a little bit to warm up to it before you start to notice some of the words. But, you know, free, the idea of being free, that's a concept that most Americans understand. But, you know, how often do we come in here and we don't feel free from shame or from what's happened the week before, or struggles in our lives or temptations, or just the fact that we messed up again and you didn't want to mess up again for Christ. We come in here, and then, you know, the next song talked about being in the Father's house. So many great words that remind us of what we're here, why Jesus came, and so I'm thankful for that. I do want to celebrate some awesome things with you before we jump into the message. The first one is that we had two young ladies recently accept and confess and be baptized into Jesus Christ through the local camp, Hanging Rock Christian Camp. Those two girls are, is Autumn Johnson. Is she out here? Is Autumn Johnson? She just went upstairs. Oh, she's going to be so bummed, right? Oops. Yeah. Well, we're excited for her. Let's say that at the end, at closing. Okay. And then Jasmine Cunningham as well. They both gave their life to Christ. She's one of our kids that comes on Sundays and just has been coming for a long time. So we're super excited for that as well. I did find out at our last ministry team leader meeting that we have 30 different people that have went to camp or going to camp from this church. And so that's super exciting to have that many. We had 90 that went to Celebrate Good Times, so that doesn't count towards the camp summer attendance. Here's the second thing. A while back, I had asked Ed if he could help me with a project. You know, we have people go back in these classrooms, a nursery, two different nurseries that we have back here. And a lot of times they don't get to hear the message unless they watch it through the week. And so we asked if maybe some of the saints of our church could come together and give a special donation so we could put some TVs in these rooms, so if they're in there watching kids, they can have the sermon playing at the same time through live stream. And sure enough, we took in way more than what we even needed for the TVs, and so super thankful for our senior saints, for our brunch bunch that meets, and just for them pouring into that. So now, there's no excuse. You could volunteer to sit in there with the toddlers and the babies, and we would love to have that, and there's a lot of them. And so we would love for you to be part of that. That's the second thing I'm thankful for. Here's the third. We have 111 kids pre-registered for Vacation Bible School. 111 kids. Ugh. Now remember, if we get 130 different kids throughout the week, apparently I will be a new cat home person for 1 week. I'll take pictures every day, so you know I did it. But 130 different kids. Now some people said, we'll find the cat for you. I will find my own cat. Thank you. No help needed. Now here's the thing though, 111, we gotta get them here. If we get 100, now this is what someone told me that they remembered, that we had at one time 113 is the most that they could remember on a single night, 113 kids. So if we get 115, the three VBS directors said they'll do some sort of challenge, but I have to come up with some challenge ideas. And so I need your help with that, okay? As crazy as you can think, I want to hear them. Okay, so make sure to do that. So 115 one night, 130 different ones throughout. But I don't know that we've even had half this many pre-registered before. So this is going to be pretty crazy. Thank you for everyone that's participating. That should be a blast. Let's go ahead. If we could, let's stop and pray. Thank God. And then let's also remember and thank God for what he's going to do this week coming up. And let's have some faith on what he might do. So let's pray. Father God, we are so thankful for the ways that you continue to show yourself in the church, not just in this church, but the church worldwide. And we do thank you as we think about that word free, that we are free from shame. We're free from the consequences of sin, eternal consequences that we don't want. And Father, I'm so thankful because this week we get to tell people, we get to tell all these kids about Jesus Christ and how we can have that freedom through Jesus Christ. And so we ask for your help. I ask that you would just guide the words of the teachers, the leaders that are here. I pray that every single person from the kitchen to the parking lot would just know that they could have a huge part in showing Jesus Christ to these kids. And so, Father, just help us this week. Give us extra energy. Give us extra strength. And, Father, bring those kids in here. And Father, we'll do our best to be a light for them, for you. And so we thank you so much. Thank you for loving us. Thank you for Jesus Christ. Thank you for this church family. We make our prayer in Jesus' name. We all say it. Amen. So we're continuing in a series called A Place to Stand. And I want to encourage you with a verse that I read. This was from my own Bible reading this week, but I thought it tied in really well. Galatians chapter 3, verse 24. I have it on the screen for you. It says this: so the law, which is the Old Testament, was our guardian until Christ came that we might be justified by faith. I like that. The idea of this guardian, the Old Testament, before we had Jesus, before we had the New Testament, the New Covenant, the Old Testament was our guardian. It was meant to help protect us. And Jesus just added to that with what he said. In Matthew 5, Jesus said, "Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets." And that's what we're talking about. Elijah and Elisha are prophets. I didn't come to abolish them. I have not come to abolish them, but to what? Fulfill them. He came to fulfill that. Now, I don't know if you've heard this story or not. It's a story about a fellow who had been laying carpet, and as he finished up a job, he reached down to get, are all the kids going, to get a cigarette. He reached down to get a cigarette, and his pack was missing. He looked out and saw a lump under the carpet. But the carpet was already in place and fastened down. He realized what he had done, so he looked around the room to make sure no one was watching. He grabbed his hammer, and what do you think he did? He pounded out that spot as best he could. He flattened it. You couldn't tell there was anything under that carpet. He went to take his tools out to his truck, and there in the driver's seat was his pack of cigarettes. His mind went to what was under the carpet. As he made his way back into the house, the woman was very upset. She said, "Where is my bird? Where is my bird?" I think sometimes, like that story, we kind of shove the Old Testament under the carpet. We spend a lot, and I'm more guilty than any of you in this room with this. I love to be in the New Testament, and so I don't spend a lot of time in the Old Testament. If we followed this Old Testament to the T, though, if we followed it to the T, it would protect us from sin. But since we can't, what's it do? It highlights the sin in our life. So Jesus came to do something about that. But we need the Old Testament as much as we need the New Testament. That's why we're a Bible church. All of it is God's word. So I hope you've enjoyed being in the Old Testament this summer. I hope that's been special for you. We definitely need it. We probably should be in it more often than what I lead us to be there. So we're going to be in it for the next 2 weeks, and then we'll be moving on from there. But if you would, open your Bibles to the Old Testament, to 2 Kings chapter 4. 2 Kings chapter 4. We started 2 Kings 4 last week. We did verses 1 through 7. Only 7 verses. This week we have to go from verse 8 to 37. So we have way more verses to go through this week than last week. But it's all one story, and I want to share that story with you. 2 Kings chapter 4. Verse 8 through 37. Now, I don't always do this. Sometimes I just put the references on the screen. I think I have all the verses on the screen this week. So if you don't have a Bible, that's more than okay. Grab one on your way out from our Welcome Center. But the words will be on the screen to help you out and to encourage you this morning. 2 Kings chapter 4. Let's start in verse 8. One day, Elisha went to Shunem. Now, remember, we had Elijah. This is Elisha. This is who he handed off this leadership to, Elisha. So if I mess up during the sermon, you just say Elisha. If I say Elijah, you say Elisha, okay? All right, so here we go. One day, Elisha went to Shunem. A well-to-do woman was there, a well-off woman. So a lady that had some resources, some assets, who urged him to stay for a meal. So whenever he came by, he stopped to eat there. So she invited him once, but then anytime he came by, he stopped to eat there. So I think she must have been a good cook, or she had some good cooks that worked for her, right? So good cook or some good cooks. And you know what's awesome about this? She didn't want anything in return. There is no expectation of anything in return. We don't read anything about that here, and you'll see that as we continue in the text. She wasn't seeking special favor with this man of God. No, she just wanted to offer some hospitality. She knew who he represented, and she wanted to serve him. And that's the gift of hospitality. We actually see that mentioned in the New Testament. The Apostle Peter says this: offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Let me say that again. offer hospitality to one another without grumbling. Have you ever hosted something and you're kind of like, oh, I just can't wait to get this over with, right? You're hosting Thanksgiving or the Christmas meal. Maybe you said you'd host one of the small groups one night. Maybe you host it every week or every other week, and you say that. This is what Peter says, offer hospitality without any grumbling. Each of you should use whatever gift you have received to serve others as faithful stewards of God's grace. So hospitality is a form of God's grace in various forms. She had this gift of hospitality. She was a preacher's friend, if we were to use preacher language. Really, he was a prophet. She was a prophet's friend, a preacher's friend. I was also reminded of this verse in Hebrews 13:2. Do not forget to show hospitality to strangers. To strangers. For by doing so, some people have shown hospitality to angels without knowing it. Whew, that kind of changes things, doesn't it? That maybe your hospitality has served an angel without you even knowing it. If you are blessed, it's this simple, bless others. If you are able to have this gift of hospitality, which Peter was talking to the whole church, so we all have that to an extent, use it. But some people are especially blessed with the gift of hospitality. I have a few names that come to mind in this congregation, outside of this congregation. But if you're blessed, use what you have to bless others. Before we continue, I want you to understand the type of people we're talking about here. These were good folks. This lady and her husband were good folks. They loved God. They served him. And they didn't just talk about serving him. It was practical. It wasn't just a Sunday thing. It was a Monday through Saturday part of their life. So let's continue in the text, verse 9. She said to her husband, I know that this man who often comes our way is a holy man of God. Let's make a small room on the roof and put in it a bed and a table and a chair and a lamp for him. Then he can stay and come whenever he comes to us. Did you notice what the wife said to her husband? She used the word let's. Why don't we? But now, what was she really saying to her husband? Why don't you build an extra room in our house, put it up on the roof here? And you know what he said? It's not there, but you know what he said? Yes, honey, is what he said. Yes, honey, whatever you say. But it is a cool idea, a room that is for ministry. Dedicated to ministry. Today we might think of it as a special place for a preacher or a missionary. I think that was the heart behind when we bought this house this way of the church. Originally it's supposed to be a place that missionaries could come and spend time. And then we made it a home for the associate minister, the youth minister, family life minister, whatever you want to say there. Personally, I think a ministry garage, right? Just kidding. Just joking. They've offered it. Maybe someday. A place to relax, you know. Now I'm going to summarize the next part of this because we have to go so far in this text. So it's a longer Bible story. So let me help you out here. Elisha wanted to show his thankfulness for this to this couple. So he sent his servant Gazi to the Shunammite woman to see if they could do anything for her. So she didn't expect anything. He just wanted to do something. But she said, I'm pretty content. My lot in life, I feel blessed, things are good. So even when the man of God says, is there anything we can do? She said, no, I'm good. I'm really good. So you knew her heart was true on this. Let's look at verse 14. She has no son and her husband is old. Then Elisha said, call her. So he called her and she stood in the doorway. About this time next year, Elisha said, you will hold a son in your arms. No, my Lord, she objected. Please, man of God, don't mislead your servant. So there's something happening here. This barren woman who's probably dreamed when she was younger of having a kid is finally at that point in her life where she's content. She's accepted. She's at peace with the fact that she's not going to have children. And now this guy's saying, yes, you're going next year, you will hold a baby in your arms. And she's saying, please don't. Why? Because she doesn't want to get her hopes up. She doesn't want to get her hopes up if it doesn't actually happen. Look at verse 17. But the woman became what? she became pregnant. And the next year, about the same time, she gave birth to a son, just as Elisha had told her. Verse 18, the child grew, and one day he went out to his father, who was with the reapers. He said to his father, my head, my head. And his father told a servant, carry him to his mother. After the servant had lifted him up and carried him to his mother, the boy sat on her lap until noon, and then he died. He died. Now, I want to pause for a moment and tell you that I really wrestled with preaching this text. So I do my sermon planning a year out. And so last year, last November, I'd planned out where we would be today. And as I thought about this, there was just parts that I hesitated with it. Here's some parts that I hesitated, or why I hesitated. One, there's people in this congregation that probably would have liked to have had children. I knew this story could stir up some emotions for them. Two, there's some people in this congregation, some younger, some older, that had children but did lose them, lost their children. And then three, it's VBS Sunday, right? This isn't a text that I was super excited about, but I texted back and forth with the elders. I said, what do you think? Should I switch directions and just discussed it with some of them, prayed about it, and I decided, no, I think this is what God has put before me to talk about, and I think you'll see why as we get towards the end. But here's what happened. This mom placed her son in the extra room that she had made for Elisha, and she went immediately to Elisha, and she went right past one of the servants, the servant that came out to her, that wanted to help her from. She flew past him to get to Elisha. Let's read it here. Verse 25, when he saw her in the distance, the man of God said to his servant Gehazi, look, there's the Shunammite. Run to meet her and ask her, are you all right? Is your husband all right? Is your child all right? Is everything all right? And she said, yes, everything's all right. She just wanted to get past that servant. She didn't want the servant of the man of God. She wanted the man of God. And so verse 27, when she reached the man of God at the mountain, she took hold of his feet. Now, I read somewhere that this was a 7-mile gap. Can you imagine, moms? You take off, how fast you would try to go those 7 miles to get someone that could help your kid. And now it's going to be another 7 miles back. So she took hold of his feet. Gehazi came over to push her away, but the man of God said, leave her alone. She is in bitter distress, but the Lord has hidden it from me and has not told me why. Verse 28, did I ask you for a son, my Lord? She said, didn't I tell you, don't raise my hopes? That sounds like something that's pretty genuine. So Elijah went to her home. Look at verse 32. We're going to skip forward. When Elisha reached the house, there was the boy lying dead on the couch. He went in, shut the door on the two of them, and prayed to the Lord. Then he got on the bed, and he laid on the boy mouth to mouth, eyes to eyes, hands to hands. As he stretched himself out on him, the boy's body started to grow warm. Verse 35, Elisha turned away and walked back and forth in the room, and then got on the bed and stretched out on him once more. The boy sneezed 7 times, and then he opened his eyes. He opened his eyes. Folks, let me pause. This isn't a fake story. This isn't some made-up story to sucker you into believing in a God. This is truth in God's word. Elijah summoned Gehazi and said, call the Shunammite, and he did. When she came, he said, take your son. She came in, fell at his feet, and bowed to the ground. Then she took her son and went out. Can I tell you a few things that discouraged me about this text before I tell you the parts that really encouraged me? Can I do that for a second? Here's the first one. It just reminds me of the damaging effects of sin in this world. And I hate that. I hate being reminded of the damaging sin of this world and the effects of it, the consequences of it. And yet it's part of it. People die, which was never supposed to be part of this world. People say, well, you know, death and taxes, right? You can't get away from those things. Death and taxes. Oh, death is just a natural part of life. No, it was not supposed to be a natural part of life. It's unnatural, but yet it's part of our reality now. Romans 6:23, most of you know this. This is part of the Roman road that leads you to Jesus Christ. It says this, for the wages of sin is death. Sin in this world is so discouraging. It's heartbreaking. And it's an experience we all will have in this life. And this Shunammite woman was a perfect example of that. First, she was not able to have kids. Then she finally has a son. Then he dies. Think of the sorrowful moments this lady has had in her life. The tears, the heartache, the stress that put on the marriage, on her friendships, on the entire family. So this part of the story is discouraging to me. And to be honest, that's why I don't like to watch news. News is so discouraging. If there's anything that I really need to know, I hear it from one of you, right? You're like, oh, should we pray about, and keep doing that. That's how I find out what's going on. But to me, news is so discouraging. Movies, TV shows can be discouraging. Bible passages in the Bible sometimes can be discouraging. For me, as I look at this story, sometimes it's discouraging to me, but it's still God's word and there's value there, and that's not the end of the story. What we just read is not the end of the story. Also, know we only have the good news because there was once some bad news. We always talk about the gospels. We talk about the good news of Jesus Christ. Folks, for there to be good news, there has to be what? Bad news. Let's try that again. All right. For there to be good news, there has to be bad news. We can't be excited about heaven without an understanding that hell really does exist. There is a real place called hell. We can't be excited about being in the eternal presence of God unless we understand that you can be eternally separated from God. We don't worship a God that loves death. We don't worship a God that enjoys eternal separation. We don't worship a God that enjoys suffering and misery in this world. We don't worship a God that's like that. And how do I know that? The rest of Romans 6:23. The rest of Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but what's this say? But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Folks, that verse you should write down, you should circle it, you should highlight it, you should memorize it. It should be in your Bible. It should be a resource for you, a tool for you to share Jesus Christ. Let me say it again. It's here on the screen. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. That first part's the bad news, but it ends with the good news. And this verse really represents all of the Bible, all of Scripture. This one verse, if someone was to say, hey, what one verse really sums up the Bible? It's Romans 6:23. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Yes, the world is heartbreaking sometimes, but God has and is doing something different. He's doing something new. He's doing something better. So we get together every Lord's Day and we celebrate. We take communion that reminds us of his death and resurrection. We get together and we sing and we're reminded of Jesus' victory. And we pray and we're reminded that God is at work and he's still at work. Our fellowship is a testimony to Romans 6:23. Our service is a testimony to Romans 6:23. Our discipleship and our evangelism in this VBS week, what we're going to do, points back to Romans 6:23. Can you guys say that verse with me? Let's just say it together. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus, Lord. Amen, right? That is what it comes down to. So I get discouraged because we don't see the same results, though. I still get discouraged because not everyone gets what the Shunammite woman got, which was her son was resurrected. Not all of us get to experience that in this life. And sometimes we read the Bible and we're like, well, why doesn't God do the things he did in the Bible? Well, he wasn't doing this for every single person that lost a child, right? He did this for some of them, but not for all of them. And so that can be a bummer. I want the type of moment that Shunammite woman had. Why haven't I had my Shunammite woman experience, or man, right? Let's not say woman. I don't need a woman experience, all right? Why haven't I had my moment like that? Folks, as I look over this congregation, some of you have lost brother-in-laws to car accidents. Some of you have lost sisters and brothers and people that you love dearly. Some of you have lost nieces and nephews, grandchildren, children, and it's just heartbreaking story after another, and you keep waiting for that moment. And I'm not saying that this story promises that you'll for sure have that moment. The greatest challenge is not to save your life here on earth, but it's to save your life eternally. That's the story of Scripture. That's what Romans 6:23 is about. If we're really honest with ourselves, we sometimes have this attitude, I want to live forever, right? I want perfect health. I never want to die, but I also want to be in eternity someday, right? You never want to die, but you'd love to be in heaven someday. And it's because death is unnatural. We would love to skip from this life to eternal life. We'd love to skip over the death part, but that's not our reality. And to be honest, I'd rather see someone, now I know this is going to be hard to hear, but I'd rather see someone pass away in Christ when they're younger, as long as they were in Christ, than to pass away later in life without Christ. Isn't someone more blessed if they die younger in life, if they know who God is, than someone who dies at 87 not knowing Jesus Christ as their Lord and Savior? I mean, that's hard, isn't it? I pray this prayer. I'm like, God, I'm okay. I'm okay with whenever you would take my kids, if I have to go through an experience like that, as long as they know Jesus Christ. And I'd rather you do it if they're younger and they know Jesus Christ before they experience something that makes them turn from Jesus Christ. Can you pray that prayer over your loved ones? That's a tough prayer to pray. But we would rather just have heaven now. Now, heaven's sometimes hard to get excited about. Here's how I think about heaven. Imagine the awesome stuff of this world. So take a second. What are some things you love? Places you've went, natural, amazing, Grand Canyon, Niagara Falls. Think of some of the awesome stuff. Think about the things you enjoy day to day or week to week. Maybe it's being with family, having meals with. Think of all the stuff you really enjoy, all the awesome moments of this life, and just multiply it. Multiply it and think of it. All those things that are good and loving and awesome are going to be part of heaven. Now take all the bad stuff. Just think of your own life. Don't try and be generic. Think of your own life and some of the really crappy stuff that's happened. And subtract it. Multiply the good, subtract the bad, and heaven's going to be way better than that. Multiply the good, subtract the bad, and heaven's going to be way better than that. So despite what's going on in your life, if you're depressed, if you're stressed, anybody stressed going into VBS week? Surely not, right? All right, if you're sick or physically unhealthy, if you're struggling with what your purpose is in this life, if your marriage failed, if your kids are struggling, which makes you struggle, if your marriage is a challenge, it's difficult each day, if your kids are now gone, if you're struggling because of temptation, or maybe you're struggling because of some bad decisions and now you have to live with the consequences of those decisions. Maybe you're struggling because you're barely holding on to faith. You're struggling to continue believing with the things that you've seen in this world. You're struggling with your finances, with medical bills, with bills in general. You're struggling because you're single and you really want to be. You're struggling with fill in the blank. You're struggling with fill in the blank. If that is your bad news, there is good news. If that is your bad news, be like that lady. She bypassed the servant. She went straight to the man of God who represented God in this story. And what'd she do? She clinged to his legs. She clinged to his legs. And that was the Old Testament. That's what we're supposed to do, right? We're supposed to cling to the legs of Jesus Christ. We're supposed to follow him. We're supposed to accept him. Do you know how we can get the closest to God today? Through Jesus Christ. Through accepting him as our Lord and Savior. That is what we are to do. We are to be disciples. I've heard this definition of a disciple. A disciple is someone who followed so close behind the teacher that they had the dust from the feet of that teacher sticking to them. And when she was down and had her arms wrapped around his dirty Middle Eastern feet in sandals, and she had some dust on. That's what we're called to do as believers, as Christians, as disciples of Jesus Christ. And so here's the good news. Jesus is greater than all the bad in your life. Now, you may not 100% believe that, but Jesus is greater than all the bad in your life. So let me throw this in. I can't be single the rest of my life, but I can be single the rest of my life with Jesus. I don't want to deal with cancer, but I can deal with cancer with Jesus. I don't want to feel depressed and sad anymore, but I can walk this valley with Jesus. I don't want to live the rest of my life without my spouse, but I can with Jesus. I don't want to live the rest of my life without my child, but I can with Jesus. I don't want to live the rest of my life with this struggle, with this temptation, with this hardship, but I know I can do it because of Jesus. I don't want to do the rest of this life on my own, but I know I can do it. What do you think the last part is? With Jesus. Folks, Elisha had such a pastor's heart. When he saw this woman running, when she wrapped her arms around his feet, he wanted to show kindness. He wanted to show compassion. So he booked it back the 7 miles with her so that he could resurrect her son. But folks, the point of this story is not Elijah or Elisha. Not the point of this series is not Elijah and it's not Elisha. The point of this story is pointing back to a God that cares individually about us. Because if you think of all the stories we've talked about together over the last few weeks, 6 weeks or so, each of these stories have to deal with individuals. Because God doesn't just care about the church as a whole. He does, but he cares about you individually. I'm not sure if we 100% believe that all the time, that he cares about you individually, just like he cared about this Shunammite woman, just like he cared about Elijah when he was hiding in the cave and was going through some depression, some anxiety. He cared about him individually, just like he cared for Elijah when he went and was starving himself next to the creek and he started bringing food and water to Elijah. God cares for us individually. That is the story of the Bible, the Old Testament and the New Testament. And it's so awesome because in the Old Testament, that idea that God cares for us individually points forward to the fact that Jesus cares for us, that Jesus is a compassionate Savior that wants to, if you're a Savior, what do you want to do? You want to save. He wants to save us because he cares about us individually. I think maybe this week, maybe God's just asking you to believe that again. Do you believe that? That he cares for you individually, what's happening in your life? And folks, that is exactly what Vacation Bible School is all about. We want them to know, like Nina shared that verse, we want them to know that God cares about their life. God cares about their life, and that's what we're going to do this whole week. We want them to know that God cares and that Jesus is compassionate, that he's loving, that he's willing to have went to the cross so that they could have eternal life. But maybe this week, it's not just the kids that need to hear it. Maybe you need to hear that, that God cares about you. So if that's you, I just want to encourage you, stop waiting. Get off the fence, make a decision for Jesus Christ, because we don't know what tomorrow holds. And that story definitely shows that as well. And so if you've not made a decision for Jesus Christ, I want to encourage you to make that decision. If you've not joined the church, you've been sitting on the fence for some reason, join the church. Hey, if we're not your church, that's okay. Join a church somewhere. We want you to be part of the family of God and to be in a growing relationship with Jesus Christ. That's our vision here at Colfax Christian Church. And we're going to live out that vision this whole week. So get involved, serve, be part of it. If you have a decision to make, come and see me during the next two songs that are playing. I'll be here in the front row. You and I will pray together and we'll take that step together and I'll walk with you through that step. So if you would, go ahead. Would you stand with me? We're going to pray and start to worship some more with one another. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we are thankful for your text. We're thankful for your word. We're thankful for the Bible. Thankful for the way that it speaks to our hearts. Father, sometimes we hear the words, we're just not sure we totally believe them, if we're honest with you. And you see that in our hearts. And so I ask that you would just help us with that. Father, if we struggle to believe at moments that you do really care about us as individuals, Father, help us this week to see it somehow. Do something today to get our attention. Help us this week as we're serving and we're reaching out to these kids. Father, I know you'll touch our hearts like we're hoping to touch their hearts. And so, Father, just use us. We want to be a vessel. We want to be an instrument. And we want to be your ambassador to be used how you would like to use us. But first, start with our own hearts. soften our own hearts so that we can help pour into the youth of the communities that will be represented. So we thank you so much. Thank you again for the church. Thank you again for your word. Thank you again for your son, Jesus Christ. Thank you for the Holy Spirit and the salvation we have. For the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God is eternal life. Father, we make our prayer in Jesus' name. We all say it. Amen.
My heart needs a surgeon, my soul needs a friend. God of wonders. God of wonders beyond the Galilee Sea.
Hello. Oh, there. Good morning, everybody. If you could get out your top five real quick before we head out. I'm going to go out of order and start with number three, which is there's a fellowship pitch-in lunch on July 31st after worship service. And we're going to have a pitch-in meal, and everyone is to bring a covered dish to share. Number two, with the Stronger Marriage team, there's going to be a couples outing at Turkey Run on Saturday, July 30th. Well, there'll be canoeing, hiking, a cookout, and more. And then, of course, number one, which is VBS that starts tonight. That's what you get when you put a VBS director up here. 6 to 8:30, the SAC meal will start at 5:30. And I just wanted to go over the theme verse for Zoomerang this year, which is Psalm 139:14. You can see it right over here on the wall. It says, I praise God, for I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. And I thought it'd be nice if we all said that verse together. So, if you don't know it, look that way. You guys are just going to have to wing it over here. okay, here we go. I praise God, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. All right, now as Paul would say, that kind of, eh. Let's do it again with a little more enthusiasm. All right, here we go. I praise God, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. All right, what do you think, Paul? All right, thumbs up. That's good. But we really want to thank everyone that has given of their time, their talents, donations to make this upcoming week possible. We could not do it without all of you. What a village this church has. My eyes have seen it. It's been fantastic. And you may be saying, well, now what? Well, we need you to pray. VBS is the ideal opportunity for kids to hear about Jesus and how much he loves them. Some kids may be hearing this message for the very first time here at this church in the next 5 nights. Please pray that each child that attends will know and learn what it means to be a child of God, and pray that everyone volunteering here this week will be able to show God's love through their actions and words. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for bringing us all here safely to this church today so that we can continue to learn and grow more about you. God, we know that salvation is through you, and we pray that you will prepare the children that attend VBS this week to open their hearts to you. Help us to reach them and be able to explain to them how much your son loves his children and wants to spend time with them. Use us and this church to touch the lives of all the children here and present your word to all that attend. Amen. Have a great week, everybody. We need everybody's help that can stay to empty the church onto the truck. So please stay and help. The more people, the faster it'll go. Thank you.